Hello, and welcome to Spokane County Spotlight. I'm County Commissioner Shelly O'Quinn, and my guests today are Jay Allert, Chairman of the Spokane Agribusiness Council and board member for the Spokane Ag Expo. Also joining us today is Jay Cronk, who is the owner and operator of Big Rock Farms in Valley Ford. Gentlemen, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks for having us.
Today we're going to be talking about the agricultural industry in Spokane County, an industry that I think often folks are not even familiar is an important industry for our region. But to get us started, if each of you can give me a brief introduction to introduce yourself to our listening audience.
Sure, Shelley. For most of the last 30 years, I was president of Aslan Finch Feed Company here in Spokane. About 4 years ago, we sold those operations. So since then, I've pretty much been spending most of my time on my cattle ranch outside of Roselia. A lot of those 30 years with Aslan, I was also involved with GSI as the Agribusiness Council chairman. So that's taken up my time.
And GSI is Greater Spokane Incorporated, which is our regional chamber of commerce and economic development council, and responsible for developing business development in Spokane County.
One of the largest business organizations in the state, yes.
Great. And Jay?
My wife and I farm, well, and my son, in the Valley Ford, Freeman area. We raise wheat, malt barley, grass seed, dry peas, canola, that sort of thing. I've farmed for about 40 years in that area. We farm family land and numerous other land that I died. Anyway, and we've been doing this as a family. I'm about the third generation.
That's great.
And
So both of you have a long history in Spokane County in this industry. So thank you for joining me today to share with the community the importance of this industry. So let's to get started. We have an important event coming up in a couple of weeks, Jay, that I'd like you to describe for the community. And tell us about the Spokane Ag Expo and Farm Forum.
Thank you for that opportunity, Shelley, because it's our premier event for the year with the Agribusiness Council. Actually, it's gone on. This is the 40th year for Ag Expo, which is the trade show part of the show, and the 63rd year for Farm Forum, which is the informational part of the show.
Wow.
So it's a premier event. It's a big event, brings in 5,000-6,000 people, great big economic impact for Spokane itself of around $14 million. So we appreciate the opportunity to show the community and our producers what's going on in the industry.
And this event will be held
February 7th through the 9th, right downtown in the Spokane Convention Center.
And with the expansion of the Convention Center, we've been able to significantly expand the expo. And so to give our folks an idea of what they will see at the Ag Expo, we actually have a video that you have shared with us.
Yes, we brought that along today. To give you, like you said, a visual shot of the show, you don't know what goes on inside that building, but this gives you from the start, because of the logistics of bringing in over 200 vendors and they're not your typical displays in a trade show. Some of them are large combines that barely fit in the door and come down Division Street. So we start with an empty convention center and show the building of that, and then all of the people and the events that's going on during the show. So let's take a look.
Thank you. great video. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. So tell me, what are some of the most popular exhibits at the Ag Expo?
You know, there are really two things that bring people to Spokane for Ag Expo and Farm Forum. The Farm Forum piece has gone on for 63 years, and it's informational. And if you ask producers out there in Eastern Washington why they come to the show, it's to come to learn what's going on in the industry. It's all the hot topics and varied topics. We have over 30 different seminars that go on.
Give me an example of some of those seminars that are going to be coming up.
Well, you have our lead speakers on Tuesday and Wednesday. To begin with, if you can sum up the wheat industry like Jay probably does, we need to know what the price of wheat's going to be and what the weather's going to be. We're going to get any rain. And so we keep it simple. We have Art Douglas, who spoke to our program for years. He's an excellent weather forecaster, comes in on Tuesday morning, and that's a full crowd for that one. On Wednesday morning, we have our economic side of things, and we have Dr. Randy Fortenberry from WSU talking about the economics of the industry and where we think prices are headed. So that kind of fills the purse to begin with. And then we have lots of other things, anywhere from planning the structure of your business to drone technology now to big data to falling numbers, just about any topic you might want to listen to.
And that's on the Farm Forum side. And then on the Expo side, what can we expect to see with the exhibitors?
The Expo side, to some degree, is eye candy, if you will. Big, fancy machines that are taller than this studio and cost a lot of money. But the efficiency and the technology involved with that equipment now is incredible. And I would invite the public to come down and take a look at that, too. My grandfather farmed with mules, and that was less than a century ago.
Wow.
And now Jay and my brother, they have video screens in those combines that give them real-time information. So it's incredible. You can come down and kick a tire and talk to people with a lot of knowledge.
That's great. Thank you. So Jay, folks may not have any idea what it is like running an operation in Southeast Spokane County. So could you give us some details about your operation at Big Rock Farms?
Well, we're busy. I get the question oftentimes this time of year, especially. They say, "Well, you must have a lot of time off now." And it's actually not the case. We do ratchet it down to about 30 or 40 hours a week at this point. But we do maintenance and things like that this time of the year to get ready for the busy season, so we don't have to spend a lot of time on working on things that we want to use at the time. There's a lot of planning goes on this time of the year to try and be ready for, try and figure out what it's going to cost us, studying various different crops. What you plant now, the price might be good now, but when you get it harvested, that might not be the case. So, and there's a lot of office time too. A lot of times in the summertime, I'll come home and I may have to go down to my office for another hour or so to take care of things so I can find the bottom of it. But we are busy people, and the summertime is the worst of it, of course. But
Jay, mining and agriculture have traditionally been an important part of the Spokane County economy. So can you give us some insights as to what kind of economic driver this is for our region?
Very much so, Shelly. That's exactly right. And, you know, it goes back so long. Even the Agribusiness Council, or what was the Ag Bureau, outdates the chamber that you mentioned earlier. The society used to be largely agriculture. Now it's 1-2%, but yet the economic side of it hasn't changed at all, if not grown. If you look at the counties that joined Spokane County, it's over $1 billion in farm receipts.
Wow.
Billion with a B. And it's over 5,000 farms and ranches. And those are businesses, just like we have downtown Spokane. But these are spread out over the rural acres of the counties. It's very significant. And I like to stress the fact that those 5,000 farms and ranches are businesses that need goods and services themselves. So they contribute to the Spokane economy themselves. So during the Great Recession, when so many sides of the economy were suffering, the ag industry was doing fairly well and frankly helped Spokane because of the things that they needed.
That's great. Now, as a cattle producer, you have your own unique challenges. So what are some of the challenges that you face in your business?
Well, you know, some of it is our lack of control, and it's in agriculture in general. We're in the commodity business, and commodities are supply and demand, and so when supply is large, demand doesn't match up to that. So for instance, in my case with cattle, and it's been the same with wheat recently, that I received our price this fall was half what it was 2 years ago. It's like our viewers taking a half paycheck home maybe each week instead of what they normally get. So that's a little significant when you're running a business.
And even though you've put in the same amount of work.
My expenses really haven't gone down by half. I know that. So you ride the good times to survive the bad times, that's for sure. So it makes it challenging, but day goes on. Just like 5 o'clock this morning, we're out checking water because it's very cold outside. So the cows still need to be fed.
And then you still joined us, so thank you very much. So you briefly mentioned this in your topic when you talked about technology, but how has your industry changed for both of you over the time that you've been involved? What have you seen as the major changes?
The fast-moving pace and the efficiency of it. Like we said, my father used to farm, and he had four boys and a couple hired men, and my brother farms the same amount of land all by himself now. He goes over the field twice instead of seven or eight times. You know, in the cattle side of things, we have genetics that can predict, and our cattle are much more healthy, and they grow better, and they convert the feed more efficiently. So it just makes it, again, in the commodity business, you have to squeeze every penny you can, and that enables us to do that.
What are some of the changes that you have seen as your family has farmed the generations?
The farms have gotten significantly bigger, but that also relates to efficiencies. The equipment has grown along with the price tag significantly. I guess it seems as though, and maybe it's my age, but the regulations have, continued to become more of an issue for us. We're an individual or a unique industry in that, if you're, and the people that are actually self-employed, you got to be a self-starter. So you've got to be motivated every day when you get up in the morning to get out there, get after it. There's nobody back there. The boss isn't kicking you in the butt, trying to get you out there to get going. And so it's an individual business that you got to be motivated.
Now, we've talked about technology. I was shocked and surprised at the price tag, and since we've referenced it, I would just like to throw out some numbers of what some of these new pieces of equipment can do and how much they are costing for our ag industry to purchase.
Indeed.
It's not a small investment on behalf of our local farmers. So give me an idea of what some of this technology, even though it's fancy and great, what it can do and what the costs associated are.
Well, that's exactly right, Shelly. And you can come to Ag Expo in about a month and see that. A lot of times they don't have price tags on those machines, but a combine these days can cost over $600,000.
Wow.
And tractors, very similar. But again, like we were talking, you step inside those and the technology that they have video screens that monitor the grain in the case of the combines coming in, what the moisture content is, what the yield is. It's just incredible. I helped my brother harvest this summer, and when I left 30 years ago, the header was 18 feet wide, and we thought that was big, and now they're 40 feet wide, almost a semi-trailer long, wide, and they just consume this grain, and he's able to, finish harvest in 2 or 3 weeks kind of thing. So. But the bottom line is you have to do more with less because the investment is very high and you have to get revenue to match and pay for those things.
Right.
Well, and I might add that there aren't very many businesses that put out that kind of investment in a piece of equipment and then let it set for 11 months out of the year. And
very true.
If you think about that, it really puts it in perspective a little bit.
Are we seeing you mentioned that the farms are getting bigger. Are you seeing fewer farmers and bigger farms? Is that the trend?
Well, I think that is the trend. You do have these niche farms that I call them, I shouldn't, but hobby farms, if you will. Mm-hmm. where the they're not actually making a living. I mean, it is subsidizing what their living is, but it's a scale of economics, I think,
is
what's going on here. And bigger is not necessarily better, but it is what it is. I mean, and if you look at in the ag sector in particular, co-ops are merging. You don't really have your local little co-op with their two or three elevators now. You'll have a co-op that spans the half of Eastern Washington in some cases. And so it's not just the farmers, it's the trend in the industry and actually economically, you know, nationwide.
Well, if you're having to invest $500,000 or more into a piece of equipment, you have to have the land to be able to ultimately pay that off.
No question about
it. In order
that.
To make yeah. a living.
And bigger isn't necessarily bad. It's making us more efficient, and you know, competition does that. Precision agriculture is a very current term, and it's very, very real, and it's already happening. I mean, you hear about tractors that are driven by GPS coordinates, mm-hmm. and it's already there. But what that also does is limit. If you were a bad tractor driver like me, you overlap by 4 or 5 feet, and now they can overlap by 3 or 4 inches. When you're putting inputs into the ground to your crop, that means you're saving money and reducing your costs or applying herbicides or whatever it may be. So this technology is paying for itself, and it's needed.
And do you see any major changes into the future, any predictions you want to make or any, or what's the, you know, what is coming up for this industry?
Well, I saw the picture the other day in one of the ag magazines I get that of a tractor with no cab on it, no driver. I had to wonder because at least some of the equipment that we pull around once in a while you have to get out and go back there and work on it, you know, and who whether a guy's going to be sitting off to the side of the field there or something waiting for something to break and run out there and do it. I actually enjoy driving the tractor, but it'll be interesting to see because they've got these cars now that are driving around with no driver, and I think prescription farming is going to come into a lot more widely used, and a lot of those things, as Jay said, are an efficiency thing and also an environmental thing where you're not putting on additional nutrients that you don't need to in some areas and actually maximizing what you're getting in other areas.
Agriculture is actually one of the prime industries for robotics. You know, we see all of our schools and the robotic teams, mm-hmm. and it's very, very real. You know, the GPS-driven tractors is here already. Like Jay says, without a driver, eventually it's going to happen, especially in row crop type agriculture, like in California and so forth, or the flatlands of the Midwest. It will happen, and again,
more and the rolling hills of the Palouse, or maybe a little bit more challenging.
Never say never.
Well, it's a three-dimensional situation there, where you have a one-dimensional where it's flat, so you have to have additional components on your GPS to operate the way it needs to.
Yeah, it really is incredible. How technology has changed the agricultural industry. And again, I just encourage our listening audience to take time to come down and visit the Ag Expo in a couple weeks at the Spokane Convention Center, because you have an opportunity to learn so much about an industry that we may still visualize what we see on TV or, you know, the old farms of, you know, my grandfather's time. And really, technology has changed the industry significantly. And so for anyone who hasn't had an opportunity to interact, to come down, visit with our local farmers, to visit with the local vendors, and really learn about how the changes that have happened over the last several years.
You know, on Thursday of the show, Shelly, we have over 700 FFA members that come in, the young people of our industry. Part of that show is also a career fair where we have over 20 companies now, which is, it's just started like 3 years ago, from one or two to 20, showing off their wares and showing the young people of today what the opportunities are in the ag industry. And a lot of that is computer-based and technology-based, and it's excitement. So it's good for the industry because it's attracting new talent, and we're going to have that.
Well, that's a great lead into my next question for you, because I have heard that the average age in this industry of our farmers is around 60. Maybe that's a little on the high side. Maybe it's 58, but it's around 60. So, and that young people are no longer interested in going into this industry. So how are you addressing that challenge? And is there a reason that these young folks are not choosing this career?
Well, you almost have to be in the family to be able to go out and farm. The economics of it are just, you know, if you woke up one morning and lived in Spokane Valley and decided I'm going to farm, well, that's probably not going to happen because it just costs too much money to get into it. My son is 35. It took him quite a while to decide that, well, maybe this isn't going to be such a bad thing. But and I think part of it is they look at the economics, and the amount of time that you spend doing it is significant. Mm-hmm. And it robs you from family time at times. You know, I didn't get to go watch all my kids' baseball games, and I'm not whining about it because this is something I chose to do, but it does take a lot of time. And so, you know, there's trade-offs there.
Right.
You are your own boss. But sometimes you're not, especially with the cows, right?
Yes, indeed.
I say the cows need to be fed every morning and every night, and it's hard to leave them to go on vacation.
Right, very true.
So any challenges that you have seen for young folks entering into this industry?
The fact is very real. It is. It has grown older. But we are attracting new talent. It is very capital intensive to get into the industry. You know, marry it or bury it, the old saying, is somewhat true. But again, the new side of it, the precision agriculture side of it, maybe if they're not actual producers, they can be on the service side or the equipment side. I think the outlook is still very positive. And the fact of the matter is, we still have to feed the world, and we're better than anybody at doing that.
That's great. So I have about 5 minutes left. So I'm curious, what was your greatest successes in 2016? And maybe how would each of you define success in that?
Well, actually 2016 was really frustrating for
was
me.
Was it? Maybe I should rephrase that question then.
Well, we
what were your challenges in 16?
Well, we didn't. We
what
didn't,
will be your success in 17?
We didn't get all of our winter wheat planted this fall because it rained so much in October.
Okay.
But we had a reasonable crop, and you know that's always a concern when winter comes, it goes away. And but the prices have gone down, like Jay mentioned earlier. So you need a bigger crop to make up that difference. We had some other things. Other crops turned out well. Prices weren't what you wanted, but you know, and I call that a success if you get through harvest. Nobody got hurt. You didn't have a big fire, you know, that sort of thing.
Well, you did have a fire in 16 in your area. I think you were mostly spared. But what were your we actually covered this in a previous spotlight where we brought in our folks from District 8 to talk about the fire that we had down in southeast Spokane County, and some of our farmers were not spared.
Well, I had it burned up to within 150 yards of my father-in-law's house, and that's where our shop is. But I had a neighbor that lost a couple hundred acres of standing malt barley, and it was a trying day. You know, I mean, it was busy.
It was
scary at times.
It was. Jay, successes or
to Jay's point, surviving challenges. 2016 the way prices were, that's
was your
for sure
success.
But you know, and we're in this because of a passion, that there's no question about that, but continuing to improve your operation through better genetics or better crop selection and facilities and so forth, that just we're optimists at heart, and next year will be better.
That's fantastic. So in our last 2 minutes, is there anything that you wish to have any question I haven't asked you, any comments about the industry that you want to make sure that our listening audience knows about?
I would say, if nothing else, the future is bright. And the public can feel very good about the food supply that we produce. It's not your grandfather's farm, as we've talked about today. It's drastically different. But it's also drastically better in a lot of ways. And it will continue to do that. And the public can have confidence in the most economical food supply in the world. And it'll continue to be that.
That's great. That's great. Jay.
Farmers are, we buy retail and we sell wholesale. Unique. I just am hopeful that in the coming years that we can continue to be a good supplier and that we are perceived as a friend, because it seems to be there's a lot of consternation amongst consumers that we're doing something wrong. And we are the original environmentalists, because we all know that if we don't take care of the soil that we have, that and the environment in general, that we won't be in business in the future for our if we have young people in our family or something that are coming up. And so I guess we're trying hard, and I think it's working. We just need to be better communicators at times.
That's great. I appreciate both of you coming and sharing today. You know, there are, again, opportunities for folks to come and experience the agricultural industry in Spokane County. They can join us for the Ag Expo and Farm Forum in February, beginning of February, February 7th through 8th. They can find more information on that show at eggshow.org. And they can also join us this spring and summer down in Rockford, Fairfield, Spangle, Latah for the many festivals, fairs that we have, so that they can experience firsthand the importance of this industry and our local economy. And so we are out of time. But I do want to say thank you for everything that you do to feed the folks throughout the state and throughout our region and nation, and to say thank you for joining me today. So I am afraid we're out of time, and I'd like to thank Jay Allert and Jay Cronk for coming and sharing their experience with us. I'm County Commissioner Shelly O'Quinn. Thank you for joining us for Spokane County Spotlight.